good to see you this morning. Amen. Don't you love this weather?
Amen.
Amen. If, you know, if you looked at the trees with your fuzzy eyes and you stood outside in the cold, I could almost think I was in Colorado. But praise the Lord for that. But I want you to know that I was thinking about you this morning, and when I got here, I turned the heat on.
Brother, we talked about that. I sent you a message.
Yes, you did. You did. Is that mine? Oh, all right. So, but anyway, we're so glad that you're here on a beautiful day in East Texas. This is one of those 2 days I can actually sit out on my front porch and enjoy it. But we're so glad that you're here in God's house today. Brother John, would you help me with these folders down here? If you are visiting with us for the first time, we want to put one of these visitor packets of information in your hand. And so if you would just raise your hand, John will give one of those to you. And John, try to separate out, you know, all the smart alecks who just want to be a visitor. But we're so glad each and every one of you are here this morning. And I'm going to ask Brother Mike Purefoy if he would open our service in prayer, please. Amen. You may be seated. I want to share this card with you this morning. Lowell and I want to thank everyone for the surprise party last Sunday night. We were shocked. We were overwhelmed with everyone's kindness. We are so blessed to have such a loving church family. The money will go for the many doctor bills we have. Thank you again so much. In God's love and many blessings to everyone, Lowell and Kathy Meyer. And praise the Lord for that. I do want to draw your attention to a few announcements in the bulletin. Sunday night, we will be having the Lord's Supper, and I think that'll work out this week, Brother Tony. If you want to know why we didn't have the Lord's Supper when we were supposed to, it's because the guy that was supposed to get the little wafer thing forgot to get it. So we'll fire Brother Scott tomorrow, but we will have the Lord's Supper service tonight at 6 o'clock, so keep that in mind. Tomorrow, some people have a holiday, only the bigwigs, I guess, have a holiday tomorrow. There's going to be a couple of volleyball games this week, and so the Saturday event, that's here, isn't it? So Saturday is going to be an all-day volleyball tournament. So if you want to come up and encourage the girls and cheer them on to victory, you can do that Saturday. That's starting at 9? Starting at 9 o'clock. And so you can come avail yourself of that, and you'll have a good time. And if you just want to go to Shreveport for some reason, you can do that on Thursday. And for their away game. Wednesday nights, we're continuing our Bible study on the theme of why are things hard in the Christian life? Sometimes things are just difficult in the Christian life. Just admit that it's difficult, and let's find the answer together and work through that together. Also, please keep in mind that coming up on the 27th is the Ore City Fall Fest, of which we have a large part in that. And there's a sign-up sheet if you can help us with any of the game booths or the ministry table. Oh, man, that ship has sailed. Okay. When they come, we'll let you kick them. We have shirts ordered. And for those of you that said, why did you get those bland, colored-looking shirts that we had last year? This year you will not be able to say that they are bland, colored-looking shirts. So, if you don't like the bland colored ones, you can blame Brother Tony. If you don't like the colorful ones, you can blame me. So there's plenty of blame to go around if you don't like something. Either way, we'll have some t-shirts, and if we don't have your size, we'll just order another one. But in any case, we want you to be prepared for that. If you're available on that Saturday morning, we'll can use some help getting stuff taken over to the park and getting set up and all that's involved with that. If you want to enter the chili cook-off contest and represent New Hope Baptist Church, just fill out the sign up, the registration form on the back table, and just fill out the portion for the chili cook-off, and you can.
Do you have an internal chili cook-off?
No. Well, we should.
Sure, we would have.
Yes. We should, just as an excuse to eat some more.
I think so.
But I don't think we will. Also, this is not in your bulletin this morning, but I do want to recognize that tomorrow, in addition to being a holiday, Miss Dina is going to be 39 and holding. And I know she just loves attention. And so I wanted to be sure to mention that. Anyone else have a birthday this week? Brother Joe? Brother Joe, are you 39 and holding?
400 and some odd dog years.
400 and some odd dog years. All right.
Tape will be 7 on Tuesday.
All right, perfect. Brother John? All right. Do you have an announcement? Okay, I'm listening.
No birthday.
I understand. Sure.
We didn't confirm this with you, but I'm just going to say we're going to have this with you.
Yeah.
Brother Scott, I'll accept gifts up until my birthday and a few days after.
Your donations that y'all made for the prison seminary, we're going to be able to deliver those and have services with the prisoners on November, I believe it's the 2nd, it's that Friday, that evening from 5 to 7. Bikers for Christ is going to be able to roll into the prison, into the rec yard, and we're going to have a couple of hours. And our son's band that he leads, and their praise and worship music, they're going to be able to provide the music for us, we think. And if anyone wants the opportunity to donate towards that, I'm going to be taking a truck and trailer, and it's going to have cases of paper for the seminary to provide for them throughout this year, this school year. And we're also taking library books for their library that they're developing. And so if anyone has anything that they want to contribute towards that, we would really appreciate it. But this has been long term trying to arrange this, and it's as you know, God does all things, it worked it out beautifully, because all of our Bikers for Christ are on their way to the Lone Star Rally in Galveston that Friday. So we'll be able to do this on the way, because the prison is situated pretty much halfway between Houston and Galveston. So we'll be able to go in there and worship and minister with these guys, and then roll on to the rally in Galveston. Anyway, it's been a long time coming, and we thank anybody that's given us prayers, and we'll continue to as we do this. As you can imagine, we had to go through all sorts of prison officials, government people, chaplains, seminary officials, and workers, and on and on and on to coordinate this drive as well as the mission opportunity.
You're not going to say nothing about that? Good luck on you. Well, I don't know that much about it anymore. Anyway, this is this seminary thing is really kicked off as a biblical seminary, and it's the first time the state of Texas has ever offered a bachelor's degree, and from the Southwest Seminary College in Houston, one of the biggest colleges in the world. This has been a real blessing for this ministry to pick this up and take over. Brother Tony and the church here has given us a little small trailer to haul equipment in, but now we need a bigger trailer. So what I'm asking, and I put it out on the websites that we're looking for a at least an 8x5x10 or 8x6x8 or something that's big enough trailer that we can enclose, that we can haul our belongings dry to these to the seminary. And it's going to be a yearly event that we're going to do. We'll probably do it 2 times a year, but we'll make it a biker event once a year. And they're going to allow 10 motorcycles to ride down through the middle of the prison, out into the rec yard. And we're going to probably, we were just going to do the seminary guys only in chapel, but the warden wants us to do the whole unit. So we'll probably have 4,000 people on the yard that day. So that's amazing. You know, God doesn't need us to minister to the ones that He's working on. He needs us to work on the ones that still need some ministering to. So God's in control of all this, y'all. He's put this in motion a long time ago. And we were just talking about that this morning. To be still and know that He's God, that He's taking care of all this. So, anyway.
We also have a little fundraising opportunity. Goodwills of East Texas. This is kind of a side item. We're hoping to turn this into a little bit of a fundraiser for Bikers for Christ. One of our members is over some of the East Texas region, and Goodwill is providing $100 and plus $1 for every bag of donated goods that we gather up in the month of October. So if anybody has stuff that they want to go to Goodwill, if they will contact us or somehow get it to our Bikers for Christ, we'll not only get $100 from Goodwill, but we'll get $1 for every bag that we take them at the end of the month. And so that's going to help fund, you know, some of the programs that we're trying to do, and you know, gas, or you know, just our ongoing needs when we have booths and we give out water and all these things, Bibles and everything that we give out.
All right, thank you John and Charlene. Let's stand together and we'll have our offertory song number 78, When We All Get to Heaven.
birthday. Wow. Johnny, y'all probably just see her hands.
I can't even control one hand making that much movements at one time. I want to actually get both of them doing. That's crazy. Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Let's all stand and sing this morning and worship the Lord.
Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood? In the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are you garments spotless, are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are your garments covered in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are the bridegroom covered with your robes be white? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Will your soul be ready for the mansions bright? And be washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood? In the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
And age to age he stands. Thank you. 7 o'clock, Miss Christie called. And she said, why is the live event not up on YouVersion yet? And I said, well, because everything has changed this morning. And a couple times this last week, I thought, okay, this is it. This is the message for Sunday morning. And it changed about 3 times. And so just so you know, the text verse today really has nothing to do with the message. Except for, I want to read it to you one more time and kind of give you why I chose this text verse. Paul here is writing to the people in Galatia, and he says, but I certify unto you, that is, I'm going to tell you, I certify, or I'm telling you, that the gospel which was preached of me is not after man. In other words, if you've ever wondered why we preach and what we preach on, it ordinarily comes out of either something that God gave me during my own devotion time and my own prayer and Bible reading time, even if it's a series, even if we do a Bible series, I don't sit around, and Russ Scott and I don't sit around and talk about, I wonder what the sinners at New Hope Baptist Church need, and we can really let them know how they should live their life. But rather, it comes out of just my own time with the Lord. And Paul is saying the same thing about the gospel he preached. He said, listen, I'm going to tell you that the gospel that I preach to you is not of men. Verse number 12, for I neither received it of man, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ. So this is how the Christian life should work. How many of you had a stressful week last week? Anybody have a stressful week besides me? Okay, now put your hands down. How many of you decided that it really wasn't any of my business, but you had a stressful week? Okay. There's only two kinds. Listen, there's always going to be that stuff in life. There's always going to be that stress. There's always going to be those issues. There are always going to be those things in life that kind of cause you pause, or even worse than that, make you feel like you want to jump. And so what happens is, and how God designed the Christian life to work, is that you spend time with Him in His Word. The revelation that I'm talking to you about this morning is not like I was in my office and all of a sudden the lights went off and there was a stranger in the room who told me what to tell you. But rather, there's no scripture given by private interpretation. That is, God tells you what He wants you to know through the revelation of His Word that He's already given. If you've wondered where God is during your hard time, He's the same place He's always been. He wants to commune with you through your prayer, through the relationship between you and the Holy Spirit that is constantly in you, and His Word. And so this week, what happened with me is that I had a couple things that I experienced in my own prayer time, in my own devotion time, that came right on time that I really needed. And some things I didn't even realize that I needed until after the day kind of unfolded. But those are the things this morning that I'm going to give to you. And I've never done that before in a message, but I'm just going to give you the three main things that God gave me last week that I really needed, hoping that that's what you really need as well. And because that's really how God works. God wants to speak to you through His Word and through the experiences that you have in your life. So just like Paul said, I'm going to give you that which God gave me. It's not of man, but it is of God and through His Word. And so maybe this will help you as well. One of the things is the weekend, last weekend, and Sunday, by the way, is not the weekend. You may or may not know that. Look at your calendar. Sunday is the week beginning. But Monday, I had all these plans of grandeur and all these things going to get done. And I mean, it never got to that. I don't think that we got to our schedule this week one time. I don't think that things happened one day last week like we needed. And it kind of piled up, never got behind in your stuff that you're supposed to do, and you got frustrated, and then other stuff was added to it. And here's a verse today, a revelation that God gave me during my prayer time when things wasn't going right, or like the way I thought they needed to go, the revelation of our today. The revelation of our today. What is supposed to go on today? And if I ask Brother Scott, he'd probably be able to tell you, Brother Scott, how are you doing today? There you go. Everything good. What did I say last week? I come in, but Scott said, how's your day? Remember what I said?
Today is the best day of my life.
Today is the best day of my life. I want you to think about it. This is what the Bible says in Psalms chapter 118, verse number 24. Psalms 118, 24. This day, today, Sunday, this is the best day of my life. Now, I was talking to some of the young people this last week about the best day of their life. What would you say? You think back into your life, the best day that you had in your history to this point. Can you think of what your best day was? Now, please, guys, don't say when I married my wife. I know that that is the best day. It goes without saying. Right? How about the day my children were born? How about the day that I got the job I always wanted, whatever it was? What is the best day of your life? Because I'm going to tell you, if the best day of your life is in your past, that's pretty sad. And you don't have tomorrow. Nobody's promised tomorrow. The best day of your life, the Bible says in Psalms chapter number 118, verse number 24, this, present tense, this is the day. This is it right here. This is the day that the Lord hath made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And it had never dawned on me before. This is it. This is the best day of my life. Why? It's the only one I have. You realize it's the only day that I can choose to go down and plant one on the lovely and talented Rachel Pierce. I can't do it yesterday. If I forgot to do it yesterday, yesterday is gone. If you're having a bad day today, I got bad news for you. This is the best day of your life. This is it. If you want to, you can decide this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice. Notice, he's going to do this on purpose. He's like, this is the day. I don't know what's going to happen in the rest of my day, but I will rejoice and I will be glad in it. I saw Tucker at Wet Pets and Critters the other day. I was coming out of the store, he was driving in. And so I had already decided. I'd already had my devotion time that said, this is the day that the Lord hath made, and I will rejoice, I'll enjoy it, and I'll be glad in it. So I saw Tucker and he had his back windows down. And so I decided I'm going to go ahead and enjoy some of my day right now. So I just kind of followed him in to his parking spot. I was walking, and I got in his back seat through the back window. And he was just getting his stuff ready to get out of the car, and I done eased in there, my head's in between the bucket seats. And so I grabbed Tucker on the shoulder, and I was like, what are you doing here, Tucker? And he, of course, not expecting for anybody to be in his back seat, he let me know how he felt about it. I rejoiced, and I was glad in it. It made my day. Listen, I don't know what your problem is today. Maybe somebody was mean to you this morning. Maybe your life is not going like you thought it was going to go. Maybe somebody is treating you unfairly. But let me tell you something about this day that God revealed to me last week and when I really needed it. This is it. This is the best day of your life. Because this is the day that you have. Matthew 6:33 says, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all of these things shall be added unto you. Take no thought thereof of the morrow, for the morrow shall take care of the thought for the things of itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. Listen, there's going to be plenty of stuff to handle tomorrow. There was plenty of stuff you had to handle yesterday. There's plenty of stuff for you to handle today. But this is the day. This is it. You'll make the investment for God in this day, or you won't. But you'll decide that it's the best day of your life, or you'll have one more miserable day to add to the many miserable days of your life that equal up to a miserable life. If you're looking for a day without problems, there's not a day like that. Sufficient for tomorrow, the Bible says, is the evil thereof. I love the new orange juice commercials. Have you seen the new orange juice commercials? Florida orange juice? Where the lady's sitting at the table, and there's a lot of people around the table, and there's a police officer, and he says, tomorrow or today, when you leave here, I'm going to pull you over and give you a ticket. And she was like, awesome. And then the guy, her professor, says, I'm going to move your class all the way across campus, and you're going to be running late. And she said, so I'm going to have to run to be on time? And he says, you can try. Right? And then one after the other, right? This guy says, I'm going to tow your car. You're going to park in a parking place, and I'm going to tow your car. And she said, I'll probably run behind you screaming. And he said, I won't listen. That may be the kind of day that you have today. I don't know what happened. Maybe you got up today and your wife said your clothes don't match. Maybe she had also, to make things worse, maybe she had also ran the car yesterday and left it on empty. Everybody enjoys that, right? Maybe today your husband made you run late. I don't know what else will happen in your day, but here's what I do know. This is the day that the Lord has made. Now, I don't know what you're going to do, but I will rejoice and be glad in it. I'll rejoice anyway. Second revelation, the revelation about our time. And when I say about our time, I'm not talking about your time as in today. I'm talking about your time as in the time in which you live. There are some things about the time in which we live, I think, that are very important for us to understand. Because like I say, we do have a lot of problems. And there are a lot of issues. And you can't get up in the morning and turn on the news and listen to talk radio and listen and read cultural commentaries. David and I have a cultural commentary that we read, Denison Forum. If you want a good commentary to get your day started, the Denison Forum would be a good one. And he talks about all the stuff that's going on in the world. And listen, there's something that I understand that God just kind of showed me about our time, the time in which we live. This is what the Bible says in Matthew chapter number 24, verse number 4. And Jesus said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you. Jesus said, what I'm fixing to tell you is how it is. By the way, that's one of the things I love about my daily Bible reading. Because what you think about life is one thing, but what God says about life, that's so. Amen. You can bank on it. Jesus said, I'm going to tell you something, and don't let anybody tell you otherwise. Verse number 5, for as many shall come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, and shall deceive many. Jesus says, in the last day, there are going to be people who are confused and have problems and difficulty in terms of religion. Well, now, this is a day where there is much confusion about religion. There are many people who consider themselves to be deists. They believe there's some sort of God, but they're not sure He is. This is a day where different religious organizations are having problems. The Baptists, the Catholics, the Mormons, the everybody. Listen, there's all these issues in religion if you see it today. But one of the things that God let me know this last week is that we don't have, as a society, we don't have a religious problem. Listen to what else the Bible says. It goes on in verse number 6. And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. He said there will be wars and rumors of war. The closer we get from God's return and Him, His final return and His rapture of the church and His judgment of humanity, the closer we get, the Bible says, it gets worse and worse. But there will be wars and rumors of wars. Boy, isn't that the truth? Watch the news lately? The Middle East is on fire. You got this little nation called Iran who are, as fast as they can go, going for a nuclear weapon, trying to get a nuclear weapon. And they say that their stated purpose is the destruction of Israel. We are steadily, as a country, funding people, giving money to people that hate us. They want you dead. Right? I mean, it's crazy. But let me tell you this. We don't have a world problem. That's not our problem. We don't have a religious problem. We don't have a world problem. This is what the Bible goes on to say. For nation shall rise against nation. Boy, you want to talk about national problems. We have some national problems. The debate that was just televised, you know what the big discussion about the debate was? Have you seen it? Who lied the most? That makes you feel good about the old country, doesn't it? We live in a country where we pay people to be poor. You want to talk about common sense right there. Common sense went the way of the dodo. You know, God has the perfect system as far as welfare is concerned. You know what it's called? Hunger. The man also says, if a man don't work, if he will not work, neither should he eat. Now listen, I understand as much as anybody, and one of our highest bills at New York Baptist Church is benevolence. We believe in helping people. And that's God's plan. For Christians to be loving and Christians to be giving. However, once a man gets hungry, he'll start doing crazy stuff. Like working. And all that stuff. Listen, God has a plan. But we live in a country where everything seems to be upside down. We lie about everything. We make decisions where we're getting further and further away from the truth of God and how life ought to be lived, further and further away from the founder's original intent and are being formed and founded on a relationship with God. We have a president who said we are not a Christian nation. What's happening? I'll tell you what. One thing that the Lord kind of revealed to me last week, we don't have a national problem. We don't have a religious problem. We don't have a world problem. We don't have a national problem. That is not our problem. The Bible goes on to say, all these are the beginning of sorrows. So you think it's bad now, just hang on. Just hang around. You think financial situations are bad now? If you didn't have a pay cut in the last 4 years, you still make 20% less than you did 4 years ago. But we don't have a financial problem. That's not the problem. The Bible goes on to say, these are the beginning of sorrows. Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted and shall kill you. We live in a day where they call good evil and evil good. We live in a day where they put Planned Parenthood in schools. Number one abortion provider. You may wonder who I'm voting for this year. I'm not sure if I'm voting at all. And I understand we have problems. Listen, I'm not going to, until I decide and look and see if there's somebody I can vote for, because I don't vote for a donkey or an elephant. I vote the Lamb. The Lamb of God. I can't vote out of good Christian conscience. And I would encourage you to vote your Christian conscience. We'll talk about it here in just a second. But I can't vote for somebody who I know is for the extermination of unborn children.
Amen.
I can't do that. Amen. Not biblically, I can. We read in our Sunday school class today. And listen, I want to see us get back to small government. I want us to get back to where things are like they need to be. But the answer is not us storming Washington and all these things. It's not going to work. It hasn't worked at this point. There is an answer, and we'll talk about it here in just a second. But I don't believe, according to Scripture, that we have a world problem, we don't have a national problem, we don't have a political problem. It goes on to say, many false prophets shall arise. Verse number 10 says, many people will betray one another. We don't, the loyalty in families is breaking down, but we don't have a family problem. Right? I mean, listen, we live in a day where if your wife finds somebody better looking than you, she'll spool up. She won't think twice about it. And she'll just tell you, I'm just not in love with you anymore. I'm like, I don't think I can stand much more of that kind of love. But we live in that day. Where if your husband gets tired of you burning the toast, he'll just go somewhere else and leave you and the kids hanging. And he won't think anything about it. But we don't have a family problem. The Bible says this in verse number 12. Because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. You know what we have today? A sin problem.
Amen.
A sin problem. And until you fix the sin problem, it's always going to be okay to lie. And until you fix the sin problem, man's relationship with God, it's always going to be okay to do whatever you want to do. The most expensive thing in this world is not some fancy car. The most expensive thing in this world is not stock or bond. The most expensive thing in this world is sin. If you don't believe me, ask the devil. He was kicked out of heaven for it. If you don't believe me, ask other believers who have lost spouses or kids or been in one bad situation or the other because of sin. If you don't believe me, ask the lost person after they die. If sin is not what will cost you the most in this world, be not deceived. The Bible says, God is not mocked. Whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. Today, we have a sin problem. Number three, the revelation about our trap. In other words, okay, but Tony, today is the best day of my life. That was the revelation I had last week. Hey, today is the day that the Lord has made. Another revelation was, we live in a society that is sick. Listen, this world is sick. From the head, Ezekiel says, to the foot. Politicians, Religious leaders who can be bought. Religious leaders who are no more than have no more of a calling than a football coach. Why do I say football coach? Because pastors and football coaches I see are very similar in that if they come in and do a good job, some bigger church wants them, and they're going to leave. If they come in and do a bad job, the church they're at wants them gone, so they're going to leave. But listen, we live in a day where pastors just have another career. And if leaving you hanging is good for them, they'll just do it. Why? Because we have a sin problem. You don't know why families are falling apart? You don't know why politicians are a bunch of liars? You want to know why pastors and church members will do you wrong as easily as anybody? We got a sin problem. And until you handle the sin problem, you're always going to have problems. Amen. So what's the answer? What's the answer? Well, we'll end with this. Our track. 1 Timothy chapter number 6, verse number 12. Paul is speaking to the young man Timothy, his disciple, his follower. He's trying to disciple Timothy. And here's what he says. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life. One of the things in my Bible time, as I think about what a horrible place that we live in, and what a horrible place this world is, with the sickness of sin prevalent everywhere, you know what I think to myself? What do I do? You know what the answer is? Fight the good fight of faith. Now, one of the things the Bible tells us is that we don't wrestle against flesh and blood. Okay? So the fight that I'm talking about is not you going out and fighting with somebody that's doing you wrong. Or fighting with somebody that you don't like. I'm talking about fighting the fight within you, that fight of faith. The fight for you, first of all, notice what he says. Lay hold on eternal life. Listen, guys. Fight. There is something you can do. What is it that you can do? You can fight. How do I fight? The first thing I fight is the fact that sin has dominion over me and will eventually cause my eternal death. I can fight by coming to Christ and receiving salvation. Lay hold on eternal life. He says, fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on to eternal life whereof thou art called and hast professed a good profession. 2 Timothy 2:15, the Bible says, that endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please the one that has chosen him to be a soldier. So what do I say? I'm telling you, listen, there are some things in life as far as morality is concerned. Don't let sin have dominion over you and cause your eternal death. Don't let sin have dominion over you in this life. Fight it. The Bible says in Romans chapter 5 that because of the grace of God, sin does not have to have dominion over you. I'm telling you, for your sake, for your eternal sake, fight. For your kids' sake. You know when it's time to fight? It's time to fight when you have an enemy that's seeking to destroy you. And you do. The Bible says the devil is a roaring lion, seeks whom he may devour. He would love nothing more than to see you come to church week after week after week and not be a Christian. Amen. You know, by the way, I was thinking this week and in another devotion time, I should have put it as a point, that you know what it's like to come to church week after week after week and never get saved? It's like trying to shack up with Jesus Christ. And he ain't going to have it. Had somebody told me, said, well, me and my girlfriend have a committed relationship. I said, what do you mean? You know, we live together and we have common bills and all stuff. I said, that is the opposite of a committed relationship. That's the exact opposite of a committed relationship. Okay? The story of the pig and the chicken. That's how you know what commitment is, right? Pig is involved, or the pig is committed, chicken's involved when it comes to breakfast. But the point is just this. Listen, this idea that you can come to church and do religious stuff. What you're going to find is one day, you're going to stand before God, and this is what the Bible says. People will say, Lord, Lord, haven't I done many wonderful works in your name, and your name cast out devils? And he'll say, I never knew you. Have you ever been through the wedding ceremony of your salvation? Has there ever been a time when you said, Lord, I give myself to you, you're right, I'm wrong? Because that's what happens in salvation. Salvation is not you saying a prayer. Salvation is you saying, Lord, I commit, I give myself to you, you're right. The world is wrong and you're right, and I trust you. You ever been through that? If you haven't, fight. Second time it's time to fight is when your friends and family are about to be destroyed. Abraham was known as a man that was not a real fighter. He was a shepherd, a herdsman. Yet when Lot was taken, he got all his guys together and said, hey, we're going to get Lot back. And he destroyed the five kings of the plain. Why? You don't take my nephew. I'm coming to get him back. He even rescued the king of Sodom and Gomorrah. And the king of Sodom and Gomorrah said, here, you can take all the stuff. Just leave us the people. Abraham said, I wasn't here for your stuff. Fact of the matter is, Abraham said, I don't want one shoe latch from you. Okay? You can keep all your stuff. I came for Lot. I came to give my nephew back. And listen, the devil desires for your children never to come to know Christ. He would love for you to fake your way through the Christian life and your kids never to come to know Christ. Fight for your own eternity. Fight for your children. Fight for what's important. Do right. And lastly, I love this. The revelation of our tranquility. Revelation of our tranquility. Romans 8, as the musicians come. Romans 8, verse number 37, nay, in all things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. I'll tell you a little bit of something in closing about our tranquility. The fact that I know Christ as my personal Savior, the fact that what I'm living for is Him, for His return. Listen, you can be worried as you want to about the environment, the ozone layer. You ain't seen a hole in the ozone layer like it's going to happen when the Lord blows that trumpet. Knock a hole in that thing, you can drive a truck through and not care. But the time it's going to get hotter and hotter. You don't even know how hot it's going to get. Bible says one day there's going to be a big bang, everything's going to melt away with the fervent heat. But what I'm telling you is as a Christian, you can have perfect peace about it. Hate to be the bearer of bad news, we're going to have a bad week next week. I'm not guessing, I ain't spitballing. I'm just telling you, life is a few days full of trouble. This is the best day you're ever going to have. This is the only day you do have. This is the best day of your life. The world is full of sin. It has a sin problem. Don't participate. Fight. Fight of faith. And then, let it ride. That tranquility of knowing. Listen, as a Christian, your friends may say, you will never win. You know what you can say? Already won. I'm not waiting to be a conqueror. As a Christian, I've already conquered. So if the doctor says, Tony, you got 6 months to live, don't come to me like I'm fixing to lose something. I didn't lose anything. I've already won. The wife burns the toast, it's time to enjoy burnt toast. Whatever life is, guys, in Christ you can say, I already won. So your little temporary defeats through your day don't mean anything. Well, I'm mad. You'll either be madder tomorrow or happier tomorrow. Either way, not much I can really do about it. Why? Life is what it is. But in Christ, we are more than conquerors. Where are you at today? Where are you at? Are you fighting it all? Do you know Christ at all as your Lord and Savior? If not, you've just about lost your mind. I don't understand what you're waiting for. Guys, this is important business. Can't have the tranquility that God intends you to have in life, the peace that God intends you to have in life without Him. Can't have the perspective without Him. As we stand together, if you need to do business with the Lord, today is the day and now is the time. It's not time to wait. Whatever the need is.